Hello and welcome to St. John the Baptist here in Wimbledon. I am Robert Mingay-Smith and I'm the Director of Music here. And it's my pleasure to present to you the church organ, the pipe organ. How does it work and what do we use it for?
I started playing the organ at the age of 15. I went with my friend to an open weekend at our local parish church, St. Peter's Brandon in Suffolk. The organ was the first thing I noticed, and so I asked if I could have a go on the organ, as I just started piano lessons around this time. The organist was outside cooking burgers on the barbecue, and Jeff became an interim organ teacher and mentor. I was assistant organist within a few months, and a year later he left his post as organist, making me director of music at the age of 16. I had a choir of 9 sopranos and 1 bass. I then went on to study organ and voice at Trinity College of Music in London and have been assistant and director of music in various churches in London. I am currently director of music at St. Marriott Hill in the city and St. John's Wimbledon, where I am lucky to have an extremely dedicated and talented choir. So enough about me, let's go on to the organ. Let's start with a simple explanation on how the organ works. Air is supplied into the bellows, which are weighted. This creates wind pressure, and the pressurized wind goes in to the wind chest and is stored there until you press a key and open the pad underneath the pipes, therefore letting the air through. The pipes of an organ are separated into divisions. Here at St. John's we have 4 divisions, the grate, the swell, the choir, and the pedal.
The pipe organ is one of the oldest instruments, from organs used in arenas in the Roman Empire through to medieval, Renaissance, and Baroque. They are feats of engineering, and although some of them consume vast amounts of floor space, they are ironically overlooked. Although I've met organists that look like Nosferatu, the repertoire and purpose of the organ is so far removed from music associated with Phantom der Nacht. The organ is powerful, but it is also delicate and passionate, and no two organs are the same. It is during the Romantic period and with organ builders such as Cavaillé-Coll in France and Henry Willis in England that the organ's development into a symphonic instrument began. New technologies meant that bigger organs could be built and new sounds made by voicing each pipe so to imitate orchestral instruments. So let's take a little tour of the organ here at St. John's and the sounds that it offers. We have orchestral sounds, of course. It's a symphonic instrument after all, and it's the king of instruments. So we're going to hear, first of all, the woodwind section, our oboes and flutes and clarinets. Next, we're going to move on to the string section. It's very much like a string section of an orchestra, but we have 2 stops, which are the particular sounds. We have a gamba, and on the organ here, we have a voix céleste, which is tuned out of tune on purpose, so we get this celestial voices sound.
Thank you.
And finally, we come to the brass section on the organ, the loudest part, horns and trumpets and the trombone.
For me, alongside the choir, the organ is at the heart of worship. Its job is to lead hymns, paint the words of the psalms, guide the choir, accompany the choir, cover otherwise awkward silences or movement during services, celebrate love or commemorate death, and oscillate between setting the atmosphere for worship and almost always dramatically bookending the words of the Gospels. An organist has to guide the organ through all of these mini jobs, and they themselves must navigate these individual roles with care and precision. On top of all that, the organ is a solo instrument, and to demonstrate all its wonder, I will play music by Joseph Bonnet and Edward Elgar.